Hey guys, I'm excited to share a subject today that I really love. It's called true fasting, and that is actually the title of the scripture that we're going to be using today, which is from Isaiah chapter 58, which is an entire chapter where God, through his prophet Isaiah, shows us what true fasting really is. If you would like to know how to go into a fasted lifestyle or into a lifestyle of fasting, particularly if, like people from my church, in Metro Manila, Philippines, Gateway Mission Assembly are doing. They're coming to the end of a 21-day fast today. This is our 21st day. The point is that after a physical fast, we need to continue into a continuous lifestyle of fasting. And it really changes our behavior, changes our lives. Join me for the next few minutes to find out more about this. Isaiah 58, we're going to start at verse 1. We're not going to do the whole chapter, but you can follow along with me if you want. It says here, "Shout it aloud. Do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants of Jacob their sins." What God is telling Isaiah is, prophesy right now. Raise your voice and prophesy. My people are doing some bad stuff. Now he goes on and he explains. God explains to Isaiah, who's going to write this in a letter to the people of Israel to confront them for their rebellious attitude. Verse 2, "For day after day they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decisions and seem eager for God to come near them." All right. Does this sound familiar? Yeah, this sounds like every church that I know, every Christian nation that I know. Okay. You go to church and you talk to your average Joe in church, your average Juan in church, and they all speak really great Christianese and they all seem like they're really dedicated to the Lord and they hardly ever miss a Sunday. Some of them even go to prayer meetings and things like that. And so they appear eager to know their God. They appear eager to know his ways. Everyone can look like that. We can all wear a mask and look like really good Christians. But he goes on in verse 3 and he says that they say this, you know, these Christians that are seemingly eager to know their God, but not really so, okay? They say, "Why have we fasted and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed?" In other words, they're saying, "God, I fasted here. How come you haven't answered my prayers yet? Hello. God, I have fasted here and I'm not seeing a difference in my life." Okay. And maybe they have not said it out loud because they're such good Christians. Okay. But they're thinking it. And maybe that's why they don't fast as much as they used to, because their fasting purposes were carnal and they're disappointed that their fast did not yield the kind of results that they were looking for because they fasted for selfish reasons, okay? So it says here, this is a continuation of verse 3, "Yet on the day of your fasting, you do as you please." Now, this is interesting because if you look at this scripture, you find that these people that were fasting really were fasting. Okay, like they were really abstaining from food. They were really doing the necessary steps that we've talked about in these last 21 days of fasting. Yet God is accusing them of doing as they please. Okay, and he goes on and he says, "You exploit all your workers." What does that mean? If you're fasting food, but you're taking advantage of your workers, then that's not true fasting. Okay, because fasting from food will cause you to end up being a better human being. It will cause you to end up being a better Christian. Fasting from food, fasting from social media, fasting from movies, fasting from certain drinks, fasting the way that we've been fasting, it should change our lives into a fasted lifestyle where now the rest of what we're supposed to do becomes in alignment with God's word. In other words, we no longer take advantage of our workers. Verse 4 says this, "Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife, and in striking each other with wicked fists." You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. Okay? He's saying a lot of people, they're fasting. They seem to be, you know, good, godly people, but they end up fighting. They end up arguing. They end up quarreling. And if we have Jesus, then we have the Holy Spirit. Then we should be developing the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. True fasting lives your life according to the fruit of the Spirit. It becomes a lifestyle, all right? And God goes on and he says this, you can't expect your voice to be heard just because you're abstaining from food if you're doing all of this other stuff, okay? You can't be expected to be heard on high if you're quarreling, if you're fighting, if you're not taking care of your workers, if you're an employee, an employer, okay? All right, so God goes on and in verse 5 he says this, is this the kind of fast I have chosen? Only a day for people to humble themselves? You know, yesterday we talked about, you know, Daniel humbled himself through fasting. That's really important, but that's not the only thing that's important, okay? Is this the only way that I have chosen for people to humble themselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is this what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? So what God is saying is, hey, you know, this physical fast is not enough, okay? It's just the beginning. It's just the start. And that's why I'm giving this teaching on day 21, because we need to continue in true fasting. We're going to be stopping, most of us, you know, for a little while. We're not going to fast again. Some people aren't going to fast again until next year. Some people, it's going to be until later in this year when they fast again. But the point is that we need to continue in a fasted lifestyle, a lifestyle of fasting, okay? Now, verse 6 says this, is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? And he goes ahead and he shows us what he expects in a fasted lifestyle. Is it not to loose the chains of injustice and to untie cords of the yoke? Isn't it about setting people free? Isn't it about making sure that the people are treated well and treated fairly and that Christianity is actually changing society for the good? He goes on and he says to set the oppressed free and to break every yoke. Again, freedom, deliverance, breakthrough, helping people out. What is this? Doing ministry, okay? He's saying, isn't it about doing ministry? Then verse 7 says this, and this is my key verse today. Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Wow. You know what, guys? This is really important. What God is saying, hey, you know what? In your fasting, you have not been eating much. So what have you been doing? You've been saving money. All right. Now, it's not really true fasting unless you've now taken that money and you've gone and you've said, hey, I've got more money now for ministry because of my fasted lifestyle. And so now I'm going to actually feed the hungry. Now I'm going to actually provide a poor wanderer with food and shelter. Now I'm going to actually put clothes on some naked people. Or I'm going to give some people with rag style clothes some better clothes. I'm going to give some shoes, you know? I'm going to take this money from this fasted lifestyle. Now, if you've really been on a fast, you should have saved money, you know, just on lunch. Hello, okay? But you know what? Fasting is much more than that. Guys, one of the most godly things that you could ever do is make a budget. And live according to that budget. And make sure that you are planning according to your fasted lifestyle. Make sure that you are planning on having enough money to feed the hungry. Make sure that you have enough money to give to missions. Make sure that you have enough money to give to the church. Make sure that you have enough money to give as the Holy Spirit leads you to other people. That is a fasted lifestyle. When you say, hey, I'm going to live below my means. You know what? I make whatever, you know, let's say some person makes you know, 1 million pesos a year. Okay. All right, guys, that sounds like a lot. It's $20,000. Okay. But let's say someone makes 1 million pesos a year. Okay. And they say, well, you know, if I'm going to do a lot of great things for the Lord, that means I'm going to live on 800,000. All right. I'm going to pay my taxes and then I'm going to make sure that I have 200,000 for the work of God. All right. That is a budget. That is a fasted lifestyle. To say, I'm going to live below my means and I'm going to have enough money to give to the kingdom of God. And not only am I going to have enough money, I'm going to make sure I get enough rest. I'm going to make sure that I'm responsible with my time. And I'm going to make sure that I have enough time in my time budget to serve and to actually go out and make a difference in people's lives. Let me ask you this question. Are we going to be rewarded in heaven for how often we abstained from food? Are we going to get to heaven and God's going to say, wow, man, I'm proud of you. You fasted in your lifetime 192 days. Wow, that's awesome. You get a bigger mansion now because you fasted so much. Is that going to happen? I don't think so. All right. What's going to happen is Jesus is going to say, wow, you know, you gave to the poor. Wow, you helped the widows. Wow, you helped the homeless. Wow, you expanded my kingdom. You gave to missions. You tithe, you gave to the church, you operated on a budget, you lived below your means, you gave and you gave and you gave and you served and you served and you served and when you could have been going to a movie, you went and you met somebody at Starbucks to speak into their life. I'm proud of you. Here's the bigger mansion. Here's the greater crowns, the more crowns, the glory that will last forever because of the ministry that you did. So true fasting is a lifestyle of ministry. What does it mean? It means that you do live on less. You do give more. That's fasting, okay? You do focus on the kingdom of God more than on your own life and on your own selfish desires. You will be rewarded by your giving and by your serving to the Lord Jesus Christ. Guys, you know, in our fast, the last 21 days, we covered a lot of the purposes of fasting. You know that it is about intimacy. You know that it is about true worship. You know that it's about killing your flesh. You know that it's about, improving your prayer life. You know that it's about increasing the disciplines in your life. But from here, let's go into a lifestyle of fasting where we live like Jesus wants us to live, where we do like what Jesus did, and where giving and serving and loving and investing our time, investing our resource, investing what we have saved because we have curbed our selfishness, okay? Where by investing those things in the kingdom of God, we will end up with much, much greater results. Let me go and finish the scripture, okay? I did verse 7, but we pick it up in verse 8, and this is where the then comes, okay? If you will have a lifestyle of fasting, if you will live the fasted lifestyle, then, verse 8, your light will break through like the dawn. What does that mean? You're going to shine, my friend, and your healing will appear quickly. What does that mean? You might have been struggling with some health issues. You might have been struggling with some emotional issues. You need healing in your life, but selfishness has blocked that healing. But now, because you're living a fasted lifestyle, his word says your healing will appear more quickly, and then your righteousness will go before you. Now, guys, when you develop righteousness, when you become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, okay, leads you into new places that you never would have been able to go before. It opens doors for you that are unbelievable, okay? And the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Well, why do you want that? Because let me tell you what, when you start to get promoted, when you start to move forward in life, people get jealous. You need God's protection, okay? And then verse 9, our final verse, and you can read the rest of Isaiah 58 on your own. It says this, then you will call and the Lord will answer. Why? Wow, I thought the Lord always answers prayers. No, he doesn't. He answers prayers that are prayed according to his will. And when you live a fasted lifestyle and when you walk in righteousness, then you are much more likely to be praying prayers that are in accordance with his will. Then you will call and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help and he will say, here am I. here I am. Thank you for truly devoting yourself to a fasted lifestyle. Thank you for participating in true fasting. Here am I. I am here to meet your needs. I'm here to help you. I'm here to empower you and to recharge you. I am yours and you are mine. Let's do some great things together for my kingdom. Guys, I love you. God bless you. This has been a wonderful, wonderful fast. Keep going. Amen.